Welcome everybody in this room today in Stadtkino. I have the pleasure to present with Chantal Mouffe and her new book Für einen linken Populismus. The first thing I want to say is, Chantal, wonderful that we have you here again in Vienna. You are a regular guest in our city. Wonderful to have you here. The book we want to talk about and the topic it addresses is a very actual topic. It's a topic we are all discussing every day in these weeks and months in all over Europe and in Austria especially. The state of the left, in a way, the state of the social democratic left, but not only the social democratic left. But it's not only a hot topic, it's also a topic Chantal Mouffe is working in a way, it's a lifelong issue you are working on. We talked already in the last 20 years about your books on the political and the democratic paradox, which are in a way studies that led to this book as a result. You work together with your partner Ernesto Laclau since 35 years on all these issues, and now these are very actual issues again, or they are now very actual issues. Chantal Mouffe is political philosopher, teaching at Westminster, living in London, and from Belgium origin. Let's start with the left populism. Let's start with the crisis diagnosis you have in your book and in your books that led to the answer or the solution that left populism is the answer. The crisis diagnosis of a post-political situation where normal people, regular people, people who don't have a voice feel that they don't have a voice, that there is a democracy without alternatives, and that this is the problem. Is this the root of the problems we have?
Is it working? Yeah. Yes? Okay, well, thanks, Robert, for this introduction. It's a pleasure to be here again. Yeah, I've got a special affection for Vienna. Many people know that. So I'm always very happy to be here, and also with Robert, because we've been having this ongoing dialogue for many years.
Quarter of a century.
Yes. In fact, you know, my interest in right-wing populism came out of my interest for what was happening in Austria with Georg Haider, in already end of the 2000, when there was this coalition government. But before that, I was interested in understanding that. So, for instance, of course, in On the Political, which was published in 2005, that was the moment in which the Third Way and Blair and were absolutely triumphant, and a lot of people were saying, "Oh well, that's wonderful. No, there is no more antagonism. The adversarial model of politics has been overcome." Said both in England, Tony Giddens, but also in Germany, Ulrich Beck, and it's a great progress. Democracy become more mature. And I was a dissenting voice already there. I say, no, this is not a good thing. This post-political situation, as I define it, the fact that when citizens were going to vote, they could not really have a choice because between the programs of the center-left and the center-right, there was no basic difference. I said, this is not something good because it's going to lead either to abstention. People are going to say, why should I bother to vote if it's not going to make any difference? Or it's going to, in fact, create the terrain for right-wing populists to come and say, no, there is an alternative. You know, we are going to give back to the people the voice that has been stolen from them by the establishment. And at that moment, so I say, well, there was right-wing populism in Austria, in France with Le Pen, you know, the father, a little bit in Belgium with the Vlaams Bloc, which became later the Vlaams Belang, but not in other countries. And people did not really believe that, no, but, you know, this is not, those things are not important. Well, you know, 20, 15 years, or did not calculate. Later, we've seen that, I think, unfortunately, I was right, because this kind of post-politic is not led to a more mature, more democratic society, but to development of right-wing populists. Well, now we've got right-wing populist party all over Europe, you know? So I think that definitively, as you say rightly, for me, the origin of this what I call today the populist moment comes from the fact of the post-politic and the move toward the center of social democratic parties, who in fact, I wouldn't even call them social democrat, but because they become social liberals, you know. Basically, what they accepted the idea that there was no alternative to neoliberal globalization. When they were coming to power, the only thing they could do was a bit more redistribution, a bit more, but, you know, not offer an alternative. And I think that, something has happened in the time. It's quite interesting here, I would like to say. In 2005, and that's why today my diagnostic is a little bit different, and my proposal are a bit different. At that moment, in fact, I was still hoping that the left, you know, social democrats could recover. I was speaking to social democrats and say, abandon this post-political position, really, you know, propose something different, because if not, this is going to be very negative for you. Well, I must say that today I've lost my illusion with respect to the possibility of transformation of social democracy, with some exception, I want to say, because, for instance, what's happening in Britain with Jeremy Corbyn is quite interesting. If you want, we can discuss that later. We've seen, you know, recent election in France, in Holland, and social democrats, not to speak of Austria, are in crisis everywhere, you know. And I think for me a turning point, and this was the 2008 crisis. This is when I began to really lose hope that social democratic parties could really recover. Because at that moment, there was a possibility, you know, if they had wanted, to intervene, do what Roosevelt did with the New Deal, you know, to take advantage of the crisis, of the fact that after having been demonized, the state was suddenly called to the rescue, you know, the state did intervene, but the state intervened to save the banks, you know, not to have some kind of policies. And then I began to, and of course, social democrats, you know, went follow the right in establishing austerity policies, and at that moment I began to realize that those parties have been too much, you know, complicit with the establishment of neoliberalism. In fact, in many countries they were really, you know, the origin of privatization, and they can't really propose an alternative to neoliberalism.
But this is why, in fact, in the
left populism, I propose a different strategy.
Why is that so? I have some assumptions. First, it's not very easy if you stand for 10 years for a political line to say credible. Now we do the opposite. That's obviously difficult. It would be difficult for me and you too. The second thing is, if you embody after 130 years to be part of the governing establishment in this or that way, it's difficult to embody that you are the representative of the people that don't have a voice. Are these the reasons?
Well, no, I agree with you, Robert. It's not easy. And of course, we can always find a lot of explanation. This is why, for instance, you know, I wouldn't want to say, oh, they're traitors, you know. I don't think in those kind of moral terms, they abandon. No, I think we can definitely understand the reason. And it's true that when you've defended, and that's true for theories too, you know, when you've defended a theory for all your life, suddenly to say, no, I was wrong. But the fact is, today we are in a situation in which social democratic parties are in disarray. And the question we need to ask, in what way can we stop the rise of right-wing populist parties? This is really what motivates me in this book, you know. We can't expect the answer to come from social democrats. So what kind of left do we need in order to be able to stop the rise of right-wing populist parties?
I just want to speak with you afterwards, or in 10 minutes or 5 minutes, about examples, like in Greece, like Podemos in Spain. But before we do that, let us talk a little bit about the theoretical idea of left-wing populism, or of your idea of populism. The one main thing is that you have to construct a we that can be the we, the people, against a them. Not only for the reason to fight the them, but also to build the identity of a group. Is that the main theoretical element of left-wing populism?
Yeah, but to answer your question, I need to start a bit earlier than that, because I think that definitively, and in fact, the book is basically a political intervention, but I also insist on the fact that it is informed by a specific political theory, you know. And this political theory has got two main tenets. The first tenet is that it inscribes itself into a conception of the political, which is called a dissociative conception of the political. Because there is, when you say, what is the nature of the political? Well, there are basically two answers. One is, well, what is called associative conception of the political. Political is the sphere of liberty, of acting in concert, and then basically the main point is to establish a consensus. There's another conception called dissociative, which is, no, the political is the domain of conflict. And not any type of conflict, the domain of antagonism, because antagonism is a specific type of conflict that cannot have a rational solution. So it's not a question of sitting and deliberating to reach, you know, an agreement. That is not possible. Okay, so if of course, you locate yourself, as many people on the left, unfortunately, do, in the associative view, then you need, well, first, you would not understand anything of the political strategy of left populism, and of course, you will be very antagonistic to that, okay? So I want to speak from where I'm speaking. So I'm speaking from a dissociative conception of political, and I'm also speaking what is called an anti-essentialist conception. The sense that, and that is very important in order to understand, for instance, the difference between right-wing populism and left-wing populism, because, for instance, in the anti-essentialist view, the people is not something there, you know. It's a political construction. It's not an empirical reference. It's not a sociological category. It's always a discursive construction. It's a political construction. And of course, this is true for the people, but this is true also for any kind of political identity, you know. So if you think, oh no, but the people that are there, and of course, you know, they can't be, we can't change their conception, then of course you are going to say, as many people are saying, oh, they are people who are basically racist. Racist, sexist, homophobe, those people will naturally always vote for right-wing populists, and there is nothing we can do about that. You know, just try to establish a cordon sanitaire or something like that. So this is the whole strategy of left populism, start from the fact that identities are not there, given they are always process of identification, so it means that they can be transformed by politics. Okay, so this is a first point. So it's true that according to this dissociative conception, politics is always partisan, and politics need to establish a frontier between us and them. I mean, that's the start from my conception. Of course, for instance, this theory that I'm referred to was elaborated earlier in the book that we wrote with Ernesto Laclau, Hegemony and Socialist Strategy. No, in fact, all the theoretical aspect of all my reflection after that comes from hegemony. That's where we establish the main point that politics, in order to understand politics in the political, you need two main concepts, the concept of antagonism and the concept of hegemony. Okay, so that's important to take into account. So, but this political frontier, which for me is absolutely crucial to understand politics, because politics is always to do with collective identities. You know, when you act politically, you are, of course, it's you acting, but in the name of a bigger group, you know. This cannot exist if it's not in relation to a them. This is a thesis, of course, that I develop, and I don't want to make a philosophical course. It's linked to the, for instance, Saussure and the linguistic that he developed, you know, structural linguistic, according to which identities are always relational. You know, you never have an identity. For instance, he say the identity mother doesn't make sense if it's not in relation to father, son. So there is never identity difference go together. So in order to us have us, you need to consider them. And of course, you know, it does not mean that this division is going to be necessarily in political terms. For instance, in order to have German people, you need to have also French people. But of course, the specific type of politics is us and them, where, you know, there is really a conflict. There are, in fact, two ways to construct the political frontier. Well, first, let's say that for liberals, there is no political frontier. You know? No, that's a thing that there. But Marxism does construct a political frontier. But it constructs the political frontier on the basis of the proletariat versus the bourgeoisie. Okay. I think that today, really, I mean, we could not go on. I must say that I have problems in any case with this construction, and we discussed that in Hegemony and Socialist Strategy. But you know, today, definitively, and I think we can develop that if you want in a moment. You cannot, you know, if you want to take account of all the different antagonisms in society, you cannot just make the frontier between the proletariat and the bourgeoisie. And there is another way to construct the frontier, which is the populist way of constructing the frontier, is the people and the establishment, you know. So this is, and here because of course the term populism is used, it becomes so absurd the way, in fact, it's an inflation of populism, everything, but if you don't like it, it's populist, you know. I think we need really to have an analytical definition of what populism, and here I follow what Ernesto Laclau developed in his book on populist reason, where he say populism is a discursive strategy of construction of the political frontier. It's not an ideology, it's not a regime, it's not something that they've got a particular content. It's just a way to construct the political frontier. So what I argue in this book is that today, in the specific conjuncture that we are living, that we call the populist moment, it's very important to construct the populist, the frontier in the populist way. And of course, important to construct the frontier, because my argument is that what we are witnessing is a crisis of neoliberal hegemony. I insist here is neoliberal hegemony, because I think that neoliberal policies, you know, I'm not saying we are in a crisis, you know, but the hegemony, yes, because in fact, since 2008, remember, before that, basically, the Anglo-Saxon model of capitalism was seen as the solution, the end of history. No, it's not true anymore. There is a real putting into question of that model of neoliberalism. You know, and I think that what I call the populist moment is precisely the expression of all those resistances against this model. And this model, this crisis can, according to me, there are two ways in which you can go out of the crisis. So one will be the authoritarian one. If right-wing populists, you know, manage to establish a new hegemony, because what's in question is the establishment of a different, a new hegemony. And it means that there need to be a rupture, a break with the post-politics that exists today, and it's really the center of neoliberal hegemony. And this is what I think that, unfortunately, social democrats are not able to do, you know, because they have always insisted, no, there is no more antagonism, so they can't establish the frontier. This is why we need a populist moment to establish a frontier, to say, no, we need to establish a different form of hegemony. But that hegemony can go into very authoritarian direction, or it can go into the question of radicalization of democracy. Here I would like to say something that might, you know, really evoke something to several many people here. I think we are, it's interesting to establish an analogy between the situation today with what Karl Polanyi discussed in The Great Transformation. Because Karl Polanyi in The Great Transformation developed this idea of the counter-movement. And he, remember, he wrote that in the 40s. And he, in
I'm
fact...
I'm not so sure if everybody remembers.
Well, no, of course. No, but remember, no. sorry. Yeah. And so Polanyi, in his book, The Great Transformation, well, by the way, I would not remember either. You know, I'm not so old.
No, but, many people don't even heard about Polanyi, yeah, and okay. It's a shame. Okay, it's a shame, it's a shame, but I'm sure it is.
Exactly, it's a shame, because Polanyi was Austrian, you know, so you should be very proud of Polanyi.
Hungarian Austrian.
Oh, yes, okay, but he was Austrian. So. yeah, you should be very proud of him. Okay, so Polanyi was saying, analyzing what he called the first process of globalization and the process of marketization of he saw that there had been, you know, for many decades this process, and then we began, and of course about the crisis on internet, a counter movement. This counter movement, sort of resistance, is society began to want to protect itself against this, you know, the development of, well, it was not neoliberal in that time, but the process of first globalization. And I think that's what is really interesting for us, is that so those resistances can be progressive but also regressive. And of course, this is how we understood, for instance, fascism and Nazism. Say they are movement of protection of society, you know, against this movement of marketization, but of course, you know, from a right-wing direction. But he also indicated, but they are also progressive response, and this was, for instance, the New Deal and Roosevelt, you know. And I think we are exactly in the same kind of situation, because what I call the populist moment is sayers of resistances against the processes of the consequence of neoliberal globalization, and we can develop later what I call the post-democracy, which is the consequence of that. And again, those resistances can be going into a progressive direction in which we are going to see a deepening of democracy. Well, first, I would say a recuperation of democracy and a deepening, or it can go into authoritarian, nationalistic direction.
So the right-wing populism is, in a way, the let's say, perverse revolt against the real problem. And we have to look out for the not perverse revolt. And let's talk now, and you said it, that your idea is theoretically inspired, but it's also inspired by experiences. Traveling around, meeting many people from Latin America to Spain. And there are some, let's talk now about the best practice examples and the not so good examples. We have, for example, in the USA, we have the Sanders movement now.
And Sanders is definitely left populist.
Sorry?
Sanders is definitely a left populist.
Yeah, but it's interesting because from his, let's say, from the things he favors and from the issues he brings forward, it's not very different to European social democracy. Not only from the issues they bring forward, but that's reality in a way here. But from the way he does it, this "I am the anti-establishment guy" from this working class and class conflict language, it's left populism, and it's not only Sanders. Now in the US, it's a new generation of people, of young politicians, like Alexandria Cortez.
In fact, I would like to say something because I think about that, because I think that Alexandra Ocasio-Cortez, for me, is exactly the example of the kind of politics we need, because it's an articulation of the working class concern with feminist concern and with racist concern. And this is exactly what I understand by left populism, you know. The two, what in is a word that we develop in hegemony socialist strategy, the need to create what we call a chain of equivalence between different, very heterogeneous demands. And I think what I call the populist movement, precisely, is many different revolts against form of domination, of discrimination, and need to be articulated together, you know. And this is what I understand by constructing a people, a collective will. We need to find a way to link together the demand of the working class. And here I want to insist on something, because there is a lot of debate in the US and about, you know, the role of the working class in and the so-called identity movement. I don't like this term identity, because I think it's very, it's wrong. But there are different demands.
And isn't it also a wrong alternative to say, okay, we have to turn to the working class or the people, or we have to turn to the identity,
exactly,
to the minorities.
Absolutely.
We have to fight both of these fights.
Absolutely. In fact, by the way, that was already what we were in Hegemony Socialist Strategy, published in 1985, what we were saying, and we said, but analyzing the problem that the left was facing at that moment, we were saying they don't understand the nature and the importance of the social movement, you know, and the fact that that moment, I was involved in the feminist movement, and I was seeing, oh, you know, labor politician, it was already in Britain, when we will go and speak, yes, yes, that's important, you know, the most progressive were saying, but, you know, first we need to establish socialism, and then, yeah. Others were saying, oh, those are petit bourgeois concerns, you know. So we felt very strongly about the fact that you could not go on with a left project that would not take seriously those demands, you know. So this if obviously was a concern of mine since that time. And since then, of course, there have been some kind of a shift because, let's say, at the beginning, that time, we could say it was only the left was exclusively concerned with working class demand. I think that today we are, to a certain extent, you know, in a situation in which the working class has been abandoned, I mean, definitively by social democratic parties, and mainly it's kind of societal issue which are becoming important. Well, no, I think that's what need to be done is an articulation between working class, feminism, racism, and ecology, yeah? Because I think that the question of ecology today is absolutely crucial. I don't think that we can have any left project which will not have, let's say, an articulation between the social question and the ecological question. So that is what I understand by left populism.
Let's talk about some more of these examples. We talked now a little bit about the Sanders and this new left-wing Democratic Party, young activists. But we have also the example in Great Britain with the Corbyn Labour Party, which we can say is in a way a positive example or a good practice example, because it took over a whole party and they are now in opinion polls just around 40%, maybe because Theresa May is so stupid, but we don't have to discuss that too much. For sure, it's in a way a success. We had also the example of Syriza in Greece, which substituted a corrupt social democratic party that is now a real minority party, and Syriza is the majority party that won two elections, two successive elections. These are afterwards, we can discuss what happened with Syriza, but they won. But then we have these other examples, like in Spain, Podemos, that are in a way a good example for your thesis, and they are really with their language and their discourse against La Casta. This is quite an example of in reality of your theory. And on the other hand, they have, let's say, 18%. Social Democrats had 18%, and it doesn't change too much. And in Germany, we have the same situation. We have the Linkspartei and the Social Democrats, and the result is that the left together is in the minority. So we cannot really, and this since, let's say, 20 years or 15 years. It's not yesterday that the Linkspartei was established. So does this really, so we can realize this only works when Social Democrats change for themselves, or if a new left party destroys the other left parties?
By the way, you forgot La France Insoumise, and it's all well.
Is this a good or a bad example?
I think it's a good example. For me, it's definitively.
But Macron is president.
But look, it's not because you. I think what I think is important is to pose the question in the right way. You know, to understand what are the reason for this crisis and what we should do. It doesn't mean that automatically then you are going to come to power. It will be too easy, you know.
I would like to.
No, but of course. But look, Jean-Luc Mélenchon is definitively the biggest force on the left in France, you know. There's no doubt about that. And of course, he did not win the election, but he came very near to be in the second round, and in fact, at the moment, he's managed to get, it's not many, it's 17 MPs, but those 17 MPs are really doing an extraordinary job at the French National Assembly, and they are the one who keep the opposition to Macron. So I think the La France Insoumise is a very good example. I'm supposed you want me to say something about Syriza, because, I mean, a lot of... here I want to say I disagree with Jean-Luc Mélenchon on that issue, because... Jean-Luc Mélenchon is very, very negative with respect to Syriza. He said that Tsipras is a traitor. I don't agree with that. I think that the poor Tsipras, he was definitely too naive. But the problem with Tsipras and Syriza is the European Union, you know, because, in fact, their left populist strategy was successful in coming to power. He kept the power. But then, of course, in winning power, he was not able to put in practice his anti-austerity policies because there was a financial coup of the European Union which really impeded them. And, of course, you know, they wanted, in a sense, I think it had to be expected, you know, because obviously for the European Union to allow a successful left populist movement to prove that there was an alternative. And it was also the moment when the beginning Podemos was becoming to be important. So they had to make an example, you know, say, no, this is not possible. Remember what Schäuble said, you know, the election cannot change economic policies, you know. So it was, so this is what happened in Greece. I think, of course, I'm not, you know, saying that Tsipras did not make some mistakes. They were definitely too optimistic. But I think that this does not show that there are problems with the left populist strategy. It shows that there are problems with the European Union. And we can really ask the question, is it possible to really develop anti-neoliberal policies within the European Union? You know, that I don't want to say anything about that because I'm not very clear. I think that, you know, it's what we need to do is to reform, democratically reform the European Union, and that's possible. Other people say, no, it's not possible. But I think that Tsipras. Podemos is also another case. But anyhow, I want to say, you know, left populism is a strategy of construction of the frontier. I will come back on that. When they come to power, they are not going to establish a populist regime. There is no populist regime. They are going to establish different, for instance, in the case of Britain, definitively the Corbyn Labour Party, they are speaking of establishing a democratic socialism. Democratic socialism. Podemos does not speak of establishing democratic socialism because they said this is something which is too much negatively connoted in Spain. And for instance, if you remember the movement of the Indignados did not present themselves as socialists. They were so in France. Jean-Luc Mélenchon speak of establishing eco-socialism. So I think that if they come to power, they are going to establish different things. Different. The trajectories are very much influenced by the different histories of the country, the relation of power. I mean, the case of COVID is, in a sense, at the moment, the most promising is the case of Corbyn. And Corbyn, with respect to the other left populist movement, has got a great strength. He's got the trade unions with him. Because Corbyn is, of course, his success comes from momentum. Momentum is the organization. It's really fantastic what's happening in that. All the young people, and not so young, mobilizing, you know, in order to create a vast popular movement to support Corbyn. So there is this, and there's the support of the unions. Things that Jean-Luc Mélenchon doesn't have, Podemos doesn't have, but that, of course, can only be understood in specific circumstances. For instance, the union in France are not very strong and they are very divided, you know. In Spain, the union also, they were too much marked by the experience of Franquism. So they are not in so good condition. But so it's to insist that the way, in fact, a left populist strategy is going to develop is going to be very different, is going to be very influenced by the history, the specific condition. So one should not say, No, we need to really examine the different conjuncture. And what I will say is that, honestly, I don't believe that there is any other strategy in order to stop the rise of right-wing populism. I don't see how, because simply social democratic parties, except if they transform themselves into left populists, like the Labour Party under Corbyn, they are not going to be able to bring a progressive solution to the crisis of neoliberalism. And this is why I argue in the book that in the coming years, the main struggle is going to be between right-wing populism and left populism. And that if there is any hope of creating, you know, a society which is going to be more democratic, is through the development of left populist parties.
Last question I want to ask, then we open for the floor for the audience. Last question I want to ask is, given that in some countries, and not so... And not only some, but many countries, we don't have, on the other hand, strong left populist new parties, and we don't at the same time have wonderful Corbynite social democrats. Wouldn't it be in a way enough to have social democrats that represent in a way a real alternative to the conservative and right-wing populist and neoliberal hegemony, let's say a social democracy that is more an alternative like the SPD is?
SPD?
SPD. Let's talk about Germany. But don't talk here about Austria,
I would rather speak about Austria. And in fact, let's say I've always thought that the situation in Austria was very much because after all in Germany you've got Die Linke, but in Austria we don't even have Die Linke. And I've always thought
that don't even have the SPÖ in these weeks.
I've always thought that, in fact, the situation in Austria was similar to the one in Britain, and that you could not imagine a real political left transformation without the SPÖ, you know, and because, well, that's one of the fact is that you never really there are small groups around, but they've never been. And I think that the this is why I've always felt very sympathetic to the people like the Section Act here in Vienna, who were left social democrat, but say we want to fight within the social democratic the SPÖ to transform it. But again, it always depends on circumstances. I think I would not have said in France that the question was to transform the Socialist Party. No, but I think that because of the history of the SPÖ, because of the strong roots it has in the working class, I see that the best way will be definitively to transform the SPÖ into a left populist party. And I don't see, I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't see very much possibility for a left populist party developing outside, you know, like something that, like the French situation. But I think, and this is a call to all of you here, who are interested in radicalization of democracy, get into the SPÖ and transform it into a left populist party.
I wouldn't have been brave enough to say it that way.
Ich sehe die erste Hand Wortmeldung dort hinten in der vorletzten Reihe. Ah, okay. Gut, dann tue ich nur mein Zeichen. Doch, for sure we need.
Yeah.
Thank you. How are you going to deal with nationalism? Nationalism is at the core of right-wing populism, and there's also some left-wing populism, which you have mentioned, Mélenchon, La France Insoumise, which for me has many nationalistic elements. So how are you going to engineer nationalism into your left-wing populism? Thank you.
Well, I think that, you know, speak of nationalism doesn't mean anything because there are many different forms of nationalism. There are some forms of nationalism which are really very regressive, but there is also, I would rather speak of the national dimension. And I think that this is an important dimension. For instance, and after all, you know, I'm not against internationalism, but internationalism means that you need to have some form of nationalism and then, you know, establish the inter. And, well, here, my reflection on this issue is very much influenced by psychoanalysis. And the fact, because I think when we are imagining left populist strategy or any kind of political strategy for that matter, we need to have a correct, right, adequate political anthropology. And for instance, Freud has insisted on the fact that the national form of identification, there is a very strong, it's called libidinal investment in national form of identification. You know, for better or for worse, this is something that really touch people. So you should not say, oh, we don't like that, you know, let's forget about it. No, I think we need to accept that and try to see how it can be mobilized into a progressive way, because this national form of identification can be mobilized in very negative, restrictive way, but it can also be mobilized in a progressive way. And I've always been a defender, and I remember discussing that with some friends here in Vienna, of what I call a left-wing patriotism. I remember that was in 2000, and it's true that something that really struck me very much when I came to Vienna for the first time is how unpatriotic the Austrian were in general. And I say that to a friend of mine because and think of your important writer Jelinek, Thomas Bernhard. They it's always so anti. Austria. And I was saying that to a friend of mine. He said, oh, but our way of being patriotic is to be unpatriotic, you know? And I was saying, well, you know, no, I think that, of course, I understand, and even more in the case of Germany, of course, you know, there is a dark period in your history. But you cannot reduce nationalism to that. And I was saying to this friend, but for instance, let's construct that you've got in your national history, very important moment that you can bring together into a narrative. Think, for instance, of the role of Austro-Marxism, things of Red Vienna. You can be, there are things in your history that you can be proud of. So develop a narrative of a left-wing patriotism. And this is what I would say in all different countries, there is always the possibility. I don't think that there are countries which history is totally negative. You know, there are always things that you can bring to the fore. And of course, I must say the French, from that point of view, have got a big advantage, you know, because having the French Revolution, you know, they can really, and this is what Jean-Luc Mélenchon is doing, you know, and of course he's criticized by extra ultra-left for making reference to la République and thinking La Marseillaise and things like that. But I think it's important because he cannot leave that terrain to Marine Le Pen. You know, if he leave the terrain of the revolution and Jeanne d'Arc and all that to Marine Le Pen, then really it's going to be very negative for the left. But it's possible to have a counter-discourse, you know, a counter-hegemony. And this is what I think left patriotism is, to develop some kind of progressive conception of the role of the nation.
I saw now three more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Here and four more. Okay.
You said there is no left populism without ecology. And I could not but agree. But why does the left or many left parties have such a problem with ecology, with really taking up this as a one of the most important issues of our times? And by the way, in Germany, there is a little hope because we have a Green Party, which is right now rated in the coming elections in Bavaria as the second largest. And it bears, in my view, the potential perhaps to become a future left populist party with ecology.
Yeah, no, I wish I had the answer to that. And I agree with you that it's incredible because in a sense, and let's forget about, you know, what's happening, the denier of the Trump kind of people who deny that climate change and all that. Even among the people who believe those things, it does not seem that they can be motivated to act in that direction. And look, let's face it, I think that it requires what Gramsci called an intellectual and moral reform. And it requires a real break with all our way of life. You know, it because all our way of life have been based on the model of consumerism and productivism. And it requires a real revolution. And I think that, you know, we are not ready to face it. Sometimes I'm afraid that it will need only a big catastrophe for people suddenly to take, you know, to react. Because in the meantime, we say, yes, there's this problem, but we don't do anything. We don't do anything. But the explanation, I think, has got to do more with the kind of what Pierre Bourdieu called the habitus. You know, we've been indicated kind of habitus of certain form of living, and we don't want to give that up. You know, even if, in a sense, we know that this is taking us into, you know, a catastrophe.
Hello. Yeah, I was expecting to hear a lot more about taxation. If Amazon is paying, you know, 1 million euro per year to operate in the UK. But also Justin Trudeau, I think, is an interesting example of a kind of more emotional play. You know, if he dances in a bindi and cries at ceremonies where people become new Canadian citizens from all around the world. So maybe something about taxation in Canada.
Well, I'm not quite sure why you ask that to me, because I'm taxation. I mean, this is basically, of course, I do agree, obviously, that, you know, it's not absolute. It's something must be done against the GAFA and things like that, yes. But that is exactly when I see that the crisis of, you know, we need to put an end to this neoliberalism. And definitely, of course, you know, left-wing populist parties need to have that in their you know, agenda. But my all that my reflection in the book is not about the kind of policies that will need to be established, because that's something that, you know, is not a political philosopher that should say that. Of course, it should be the policies are going to be taken by the different movement. My reflection was a different in kind of a strategy, a political strategy, in order to bring the end of neoliberal hegemony, and of course that implies, you know, doing something against the GAFA. Speaking of Trudeau, I'm not quite sure, you know, it's definitely not my cup of tea, because it's like Macron, there is a kind of a clone of Macron, and I don't think that, you know, this is where, you know, kind of progressive politics can be expected.
Thank you. I think I have to ask two questions, if that's okay. So my first question is, what do you think of degrowth as a concept?
Of what?
Degrowth.
Degrowth, yeah.
As a concept, and a scientific concept, and social movement as a vision for the left. And the second question would be, right now there are all these right populist parties in so many countries in Europe. And also they gain more power and they are more into hate speech. And when is the point, or under what conditions would you stop talking about right populism and call it more fascist parties? Or like when is the line between right populism and fascism?
Okay, well, thanks for this question, because I think it's something what I would need to clarify. First, very quickly, I'm very sympathetic to degrowth, you know what I think, and in fact, what everything I was saying about the need to have a moral intellectual reform and put into question the productivism, and that definitely I think it's a reflection which I'm sympathetic to. The other question I think is quite important, because I have been and I'm still being very much criticized for not wanting, for instance, to say that Marine Le Pen is extreme right. You know, so why don't you call her popular? Well, here I've got, first, look, I'm not, obviously, extreme right exists. You know, I'm not saying that there is no extreme right, but I think it's very important to make the difference, because extreme right is, if we take the term, you know, in a meaningful way, not simply saying, oh, it's what is the left, sorry, of the right of the traditional right, you know, because extreme right is something which means, for instance, movement which are definitively against the representative democracy, want to bring down the actual institution of liberal democracy, that use violence. I mean, they exist, but they are marginals. And I don't think at the moment they represent a big threat. They might become more important, but at the moment, but more importantly than that, I think that calling those movement fascist or extreme right is in fact a very convenient way for the good Democrats to avoid making an examen de conscience, to examine what is their responsibility in the growth of those movements. Because one of my main questions in the book is that why is it, I need to try to understand why is it that important sector of the working class, for instance, are voting for those parties? You know, and I do not accept the explanation of several people. In fact, I've got in France a debate with Eric Fassin about that. They say we should not even try to consider people. They are inherently fascist, homophobic, racist. So, you know, let's forget about them. I do not believe that all those people, of course there are people like that, but basically I think, I mean, I suppose you must have read, because I know in the German world it has been very successful, the book by Didier Eribon, Retour à Reims, Rocker, where he really worries about the fact that his family, who was basically, you know, who left and even communist, when he went back there 30 years later, he realized they were all voting for the National Front. And, you know, we just need to, and I wonder, why? What's the explanation for that? And Didier says, and I totally agree with him, because they've been abandoned by the Socialist Party. Those people have felt that the only party that was really, you know, speaking to them and dealing with their concern was the National Front. So I think that this is something for me which is really important to try to understand, because we are not going to be able to fight against those parties if we do not understand why important sector of the population vote for them. And that, of course, examination will lead you to make an autocritic, you know? And this is why I always insist that the main responsible, in my view, for the development of right-wing populism are the social democrats, which have abandoned the working class. This is, you know, those are fascists, those are... Macron recently spoke of the populist leper, can you imagine? So it means, in fact, this is some kind of moral disease. You know, it's something that the return of the brown plague is something like, you know, a phenomenon of the weather, we don't know. So what can we do about that? First, we don't have anything to do. We are not responsible for that, first. And then, how are we going to fight against it? Well, we don't really know. And I think that it's a solution of facility to say, that's return of fascism, that extreme right. And I insist calling that right-wing populist, because I want to say that, in fact, the origin, most of the demands are democratic demands, because they are resistances against the post-democracy, which is the consequence of 30 years of neoliberal hegemony. And of course, those demands, democratic demands, are articulated in xenophobic and nationalistic vocabulary by right-wing populism. And this is where the anti-essentialist thinks is important, you know, because if you don't realize that a specific demand can be articulated into different vocabularies, then of course you are going to say, well, those are those people, you know, okay, forget about them. And the whole question of left populism is to try to see, okay, what are the real democratic demands and how we can really formulate them differently. I mean, I give you, if I've got, no more minute? Okay.
I think we have two questions left here. I couldn't see this too good because there is this light.
I want to ask a question again that's maybe very obvious, but it's about the use of the word populism. I just read your book for Left Populism, but before that I read a book called What is Populism? But by Jan Werner Müller, where he gives a bit of a different definition of populism. He establishes this opposition between we, the people, and the establishment, but he says that populists always make a moral claim and say that they are the only legitimate representatives of the people, and in that way they exclude other groups. I would think that you would define this as right-wing populism, but according to his definition of populism, there can be no left populism, because the left is inclusionary and it's trying to include more voices, etc. So do you think there is a danger in using a word like populism that has such different understandings, and it's seen very negatively, especially in the European context, and is also related to this idea of the charismatic leader often? So maybe you could also comment on that. How do you see this charismatic leader? Is there a place for that in left populism?
Thank you. Just coming back to the question, how could we transfer your ideas to the European level? Do you believe that we can reform the European Union from inside?
Thank you for your passionate talk, both of you. I agree with the idea to define frontiers. I want to ask you about how you think about the importance of civil society movements to endorse a left populism. At the moment, I see a chance in Austria also that a lot of people that do or are engaged in partly things they do. But I think there is a frontier that is not really talked about the new smart guys who think the neoliberal system is triumphating. Sorry for my English, but I think like in Austria, the movement of the Türkis and Mr. Kurz, you really have to go through his talks and analyze it. When he talks about efficiency, it's a sort of deadly efficiency, and nobody really moves strongly to this wording. But I think now the new lady in the SPÖ, she says she wants to work with civil society in a broad sense for new values who are more on the left side. So maybe there's a chance.
Well, I'm afraid that how long do I have to answer that? Two minutes? Or what? 5 minutes? Okay. Well, all right. So the question of the European Union, I'm really can't answer that because I'm not. Let's say I could say I wish it can be reform. I wish because I think that I'm against the really existing European Union, which is neoliberal. But I don't believe, I'm not a sovereignist. I'm not going to say we should go back to. And on the other side, we can't do without Europe. So we need to have a different kind of Europe. You know, so that's the only thing I can say at the moment. The question of social movement. Yes, of course. I mean, I did not have time to develop that. But the left populism is seen some kind of party movement, you know. It's an articulation between what I call the horizontal and the vertical. That is, it's an articulation of demand and group of the social movement with an element of what Podemos call machine de guerre électorale, an electoral war machine, you know, because left populist parties want to come to power. It's not the kind of testimonial left of the ultra-left, you know. They want to come to power, so they need to take part in the election, so they need to have a party dimension. But it's not purely party. It's also articulation with social movement. And it's not also that the difference, for instance, with the pure social movement, because they are part of the left who believe that things will come simply by social movement. Left populism would say no, neither pure social movement nor pure party form. It's an articulation of party form with social movement. So that's it. Well, no to the last question. Well, obviously you imagine that I disagree with what Werner Müller said in his book, but basically I think we talk about different things. Because first, most of analysis is like, it's the populist regime, and I've just said that, you know, according to me, populism is not a regime. And I also believe that the problem is that, let's say, all his book is about, he say, what is populism? But he in fact, refers to only one form of populism. I'm not saying that this form of populism does not exist. Of course, there are populism which construct the frontier on moral term. But there are many, he's kind of apostasized. He says he's constructing an ideal type, but I don't think he really read seriously Weber, because this is not, what he does is not at all constructing an ideal type. He's just taking one example, and basically he only almost refers to Orban. He never speaks, for instance, of Marine Le Pen, or, and I personally believe that, and that I've been having discussion with many people in Austria, in Hungary, that I don't say that Orban for me is not a populist. Orban is an authoritarian, nationalistic, conservative leader, but I don't see really what is populist in Orban, you know. So I think it's you just take one case, analyze it, and this is what populism is. And of course, then when you say, well, but for instance, there are other forms of populism, and I refer, and because we were together at the IVM last year, so I had time to discuss with him. And I say, for instance, Podemos, you know, is different. He said, ah, yeah, but Podemos is not left populist. It's not populist. And I say, what you mean? But they define themselves like as left populist. They say, I don't know, but they are not populist. I mean, they are not populist according to the definition that Mr. Werner Müller makes of populism. Okay, yeah, all right. And in fact, what is funny is that according to the definition that Mr. Werner Müller makes of populism, the populist party in the U.S., you know, which is the turn of the last century, is not populist. So he defined what is populist, and there you are either for accept that. So honestly, I must say that I don't think that is very useful. But of course, they are a form of populism that construct the frontier in that way. But there are many other forms. And if we want to understand really the importance of populism, and particularly how to fight against it, you need to have a different definition than just saying, you know, it's necessarily anti-pluralist, it's necessarily constructed in moral terms, and the people is, you know, only the good people. It said that it's always constructed in moral terms, you know. And I think it does not help you to understand the variety of populism. And so it's really not a question of saying, I mean, I analyze the things in a completely different way. So this is where there is a basic difference. We can't even compare the things, you know. We speak about different things.
Thank you, Chantal. Thank you, everybody here. For sure, you can buy this book outside, and I'm sure Chantal will also sign some of them if you want. I thank you very much for this also passionate and inspiring hour and some minutes, and also you for your passionate impulses, which are important in this country, because it shows to us that there are a lot of people who want to start doing something and change the political path of this country to a better way, to the better. And as we all know, this is very, very necessary. Thank you, Chantal, to be with us. And we are sure we will meet again on such a floor in the next months or weeks or years ago. Thank you very much.